the subject of photography, which isn't really academic. So I'd be told within the video. We can make it
academic.
And not being very good in school. Family life was atrocious. It was a bit crazy. And then having going to a school where no one liked me, you know, and the chance not to wear a uniform when I was age 15 to 16, you know, and then to wear a Crombie, and then to wear my stained dress, and then to wear my Arrington, and to wear my Ronnie, you know, was the first time that I had a sense of belonging, a sense of identity, and going to support Cardiff City to be a Cardiff skin. And also an identity with music as well. Skinheads to like reggae music. Reggae music, a little bit more tidy with it. I like the beat. To have that sense of identity, it was different to the, you know, there was no, such a thing as racialism. You didn't understand that. It wasn't clever enough for that. But it was a young artistic pupil, really, you know, tying into a culture where I felt important, where I could wear yellow socks, you know, and I could spend hours, you know, I'm gone now. and I could spend hours, you know, polishing up Dr. Martens, getting spit. I told my father and son that my father loved this. Because I had a tidy haircut, you know, a tight haircut, and it was clean cut. It was tremendous, you know. And then, of course, going to watch Cardiff City and tremendously, but then of course it started to get a little bit dangerous. I was also a Manchester United self-supporter, and Cardiff were playing Manchester United in the second division, and I was with my friends, we meet halfway, and then I turned court, then I'd be Manchester United self-supporter, you know. But having that identity, that sense of belonging, and a wider belonging, you know, my culture was becoming wider. It's not local now, you know, and it was lovely, really. It was tremendous. And then to see those skinheads in Bertha, I can remember taking their pictures. There's one of the original skinheads, and he's gone. And I took their pictures, and there was my wife, and there was a little bit, and there she was beside her. I think she was nervous. And I took their picture, then they all dispersed, and they all ran towards the little red mini. And my wife was utterly petrified. But to be in a place like Merthyr Tydfil, where the culture was so diverse, you know, skinheads, punk rockers, rockabillys, what an environment, vibrant, you know, vibrant with good culture, it was tremendous. And the rebirth of the original skinheads, you know, you're copying them, so it was a lovely experience, really. And a young generation, you know, a sense of belonging, a sense of culture, it's a bit like the miners here, you know, the group, they belong. You know, they belong, the sense of identity. And I've had that. I always belonged to my home area. And that was an extension of that. And I'll tell you naughty things that I did.
One quick thing, which I think Mark had spotted, that the miner's picture here, where he's holding his lunchbox, is a spoof on the budget. Yeah. The budget. So, you know, like an interesting sense of humour.
Yes. I had a woman, really, and I remember doing my degree show, and she came from the Arnold family, and she said, "Duh," she said, these men are sexy for you. And they were my film stars, they were my Clark Gables. You know, after shift, and I'm with an old camp, Dolphy Campbell, and it takes me ages to set up, you know. And that ritual of a relationship with them, you know, that comes because of the person that you are, really. Do you know what I mean? And it was something I treasure for the rest of my life. And you look at my pictures, you know, David and Mark came up with some pictures, and I'd done all digitally, you know, but I lost my notes, discovered them. And I spent ages, you know, on Photoshop, looking perfect, you know. I didn't like those, but they saw the old prints, you know, all the mess, you know. And there's like a reverence to these original prints. Tremendous. It's great. But the memories, really, that will last me forever. I remember on those houses in the Black Grounds, talking about simple, banal things, really. And it was winter time. The winters here was severe. I remember Glandon, a local carter, took me into the house and it was freezing. He said, "Oh, good." And he said, "Do you have something to eat?" I said, "I'd love something to eat." And I go, and he's making me a banana sandwich. I could have done with a bowl of soup. and then he cut the banana in his slices and then squashed them in, you know. I discovered I'm making a banana sandwich. And every time I feel like, bless you, late at night, I make myself a banana sandwich, I go back to the Black Ramps in Glenavon, a cold, cold day in that little front house and a banana sandwich.
Any other questions, comments? Feel free.
I deviated there from the skinners,
didn't I? Doug and Dale.
Yes.
I'm sorry to implicate you, but you worked with
economic migrants, you worked.
You economic migrants. Just explain a little bit about the school and...
Oh, I came from London to Merthyr Tydfil to work for the Hoover Company for a year in 1960. And it went on, and eventually my wife ended up teaching at a school.
Russian and German.
Russian and German, due to a very adventurous head teacher who was trying to extol the virtues of comprehensive schools, and that was quite successful. And we have maintained the connection every time that I wanted to move to a different job. It was still, well, I'll get a job, but I'll still live in Merthyr and I'll travel and whatever. I just felt no desire whatsoever to go back to the next city, in London, where I got to school. And I have a relationship, as Walter describes, with a lot of these guys, their pictures, because they came from underground to work in Hoover.
Yes.
They came up, but at that time, there was no shortage of jobs. We had to compete labour from the pits into the domestic appliance industry or into the steelworks. Now, there was full employment in Merthyr. There were five or six big employers, and then throughout the last 20 years, it's gradually come to the point where there are none of those industries left. But we've got replacements like EE. We've got a massive telephone exchange system there, which employs about 2,000 people. So I mean, there is still actually not a lot of unemployment in Merthyr if you want to work. There is this reputation, unfortunately, with some people who've been publicised that they just don't want to work, or it's too difficult, or they've abused their educational opportunities, and therefore they are good for me. But I can tell you, it's not really true. You know? And if you want to live somewhere that's really convenient and nice near a national park, etc., which is going to have a very good train service in the future, then come up the valleys.
There are two Costa coffees on the retail centre. That would be a bit debonant.
You've already said that. You've got the bridge end out
there. Yeah, did you mention Martin Spencer?
We do actually run trips from Mid Wales now down to our Marks and Spencers in Merthyr Tydfil.
And we would run a trip from Pennar. I'll chat with Mia. Is she here? Are you? Is she?
Who?
Mia.
No, she's not. Well,
tell her Tuesday I'll arrange a trip.
We do have a Pennar for the.
Yes, we've got 8 minutes on.
Any.